Greetings, family. Welcome to the African Exodus Show. I'm your host, Tierney Cherie, here to you with a new video. Before we get started with today's show, I want to remind you, if you would like to stay connected outside of YouTube, the best way to do so is on Telegram. There I post anytime that I upload a video, and it's also the best place to message me. In addition, if you wish to support this channel, you can do so two ways. You can do so through Cash App. In addition, you can do so through Patreon. There I also post a weekly exclusive just for you. We are continuing on with the Law series. Remember, the entire purpose of this series is to demonstrate, not using my own thoughts, not using my own philosophies or theology, but using scripture, the fact that the law is still practiced today. However, the means by which this practice is not what it was inside of the Old Testament. And that is why you have to understand, number one, what happened, what was wrong with the law of Moses. As we said, nothing was wrong with the law of Moses. What was wrong was the Israelites. They could not obey the law of Moses because they had not died to their flesh. They had not followed the law with their heart. They followed the law half-heartedly. At some point, you would have Israel have a mass turning back to the Most High, but at most times they were in some type of rebellion, mixing up their religious beliefs with the beliefs of the nations around them, straight up abandoning the law at certain points, killing the prophets even in order to affirm their own lawlessness. All of these things was happening in Israel, and that's why the law could not be followed, because the people had not followed Yah with their heart. So we broke that down previously, and what we're going to talk about today is the fact that we do still follow the law. However, we do not follow it through our flesh like was done under the law of Moses. Today we're going to talk about the law of the Spirit, a concept that most Christians have not heard of, despite the fact that this is Old, New Testament, law of the Spirit, New Testament teaching, New Testament revelation, one that was revealed through Yahushua whenever he died and was resurrected by the Spirit of Yahuwah. So one thing we're going to do, I want to start this off by going through some scriptures. The last video that I did where I spoke about the fact that we are saved by grace, but we're given that grace to follow the commandments. I got a lot of people who started posting scriptures from the Apostle Paul, different letters inside of the New Testament. Many people who come out speaking about what Paul says inside of his letters, many people who have this grace doctrine that since essentially you believe in Yahushua or Jesus, as some of you might say, you believe in him, and then at that point, sins are forgiven, don't have to worry about following the law. Many people who pull scriptures from Paul in order to get that interpretation are doing so without reflecting the fact that Paul was not speaking as a new teaching. He was literally pointing to something that was in the Old Testament. And you would not understand that unless you understood that Paul was deeply embedded inside of the Old Testament, inside of the Old Law. He studied the Old Law. He uses verbiage that literally comes from the Old Law. And because we've skipped over having a thorough analysis of how the Old Law pertains to the New Law, many of us instead attach our own meanings of what Paul is saying. So when Paul says, oh, you're not saved by the works, you're saved by your grace, we might say, oh, good, that means that we don't have to work, we don't have to do anything in order to get Yah's approval. But if you don't think about the fact that Yah's grace is something that was extended throughout the Old Testament, Abraham received Yah's grace. Moses received Yah's grace all throughout Yasharel. These people who were following or told to follow the commandments were also being extended his grace and his favor. If you don't have that analysis, then you will instead attach your own meaning to grace, which has literally happened inside of the New Testament context. You have people who created a new definition of grace, that grace means I can essentially not ever worry about whether or not I'm following the commands or not. Which, again, in their interpretation, grace could easily be seen to be lawlessness. So what we're going to do, I want to first start off reading some of these scriptures that I was given from the last teaching I did, where some people were debating, other people were asking out of just curiosity. Hey, you know, these scriptures of Paul, it doesn't seem to match up with what you're saying, that we are supposed to follow the commandments. So let's start with Galatians 3:13. Christ redeemed us, or HaMashiach redeemed us, from the curse of the law. Having become a curse for us, it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. That was one of the scriptures that was sent to me. That's also a scripture that I myself have taken with understanding to mean, because other people gave me this interpretation, that the law is in itself a curse. Now, unfortunately, again, we're not thinking from an Old Testament mindset whenever we come to that conclusion, because if you think about what is the curse of the law, let's go down and see what the curse of the law is. Deuteronomy 11, verse 26 through 28 says, "See, I am placing before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you listen to the commandments of Yahuwah, your Elohim, which I am commanding you today, and the curse, if you do not listen to the commandments of Yahuwah, your Elohim, but turn aside from the way which I am commanding you today by following other gods which you have not known." Notice this clearly says that I am setting before you a blessing and a curse. Again, Paul is a studier of the law. He studied the Old Testament. He knows about these terms. The curse of the law is if you don't follow the commandments. So essentially, if you follow the commandments, then you get the blessing of the law, the blessing being all the blessings that Yah told to the children of Yasharel, that they would be a nation that is powerful, that they would be abundant, that they would be blessed by Yah. That would have been the blessing of the law. But then we're also given the curse of the law. The curse of the law, if Yasharel does not follow the commandments, then they become a curse. So when Paul says in Galatians, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, the curse of the law, meaning he redeemed Yasharel from their disobedience, from the fact that they were a curse in this world because of the fact that they broke the covenant with Yahuwah. So I think it's best to read the full context of that verse and not just pick out one particular verse. So let's read verses 10 through verses 14 of Galatians 3. "For all who are works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who does not abide by the things written in the book of the law to do them.'" Literally saying what we just said. The curse of the law applies to anyone who does not follow the law. "Now that no one is justified by the law before God is evident, for the righteous one will live by faith. However, the law is not of faith. On the contrary, the person who performs them will live by them. HaMashiach redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse, for it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree,' in order that HaMashiach Yahusha, the blessing of Abraham, would come to the Gentiles so that we would receive the promise of the Spirit through faith." So let's break this down slowly. When Paul is telling us that essentially, if you are under the law, you are under a curse. That is because the law was not fulfilled. So we have to understand Yasharel is very much pertinent to the world whenever it comes to whether or not the law would extend to humanity or not. Through Yasharel, the whole world would be blessed. So if Yasharel failed in following the commandments, that means that essentially it's up for everyone else. And so the fact that they did fail means that the law for everyone in Yasharel and anyone potentially trying to receive the blessing of Yah by becoming a part of Yasharel, because they were not keeping the law, they became a curse, and everyone attached to them became a curse. And because they became a curse, that is why it says in verse 11 that no one is justified by the law before Yahuwah. It is evident the righteous one will live by faith, meaning no one became justified by the law because Yasharel did not follow the law. They broke their covenant. The covenant is now a curse to them because they did not follow the law to receive the blessings. So I hope that is clear. I want us to move on to another scripture. So another one that I received was Galatians 2. I'm going to read 15 through 21. "We are Jews by nature, or Yahudim by nature, and not sinners from the Gentiles. Nevertheless, knowing that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in HaMashiach Yahusha, even we have believed in HaMashiach Yahusha, so that we may be justified by faith in HaMashiach and not by the works of the law, since by works of the law no flesh will be justified. But if we are seeking to be justified in HaMashiach, we ourselves have also been found sinners. Is HaMashiach then a servant of sin? Far from it. If I rebuild what I once destroyed, I prove myself to be a wrongdoer. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for Yahuwah. I have been crucified with HaMashiach. And it is no longer I who live, but HaMashiach lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of Elohim, who loved me and gave himself up for me. I do not nullify the grace of Yahuwah, for if righteousness comes through the law, then HaMashiach died needlessly. So again, we have to read this with an Old Testament context. It has already been established that Yasharel did not follow the law. The law is therefore a curse. They had a covenant with Yahuwah. They broke their covenant in the same way that if you have a contract with someone and you break your contract, now you are guilty. Now you have a judgment against you. So we are in a phase where Yasharel has broken that covenant. It is accepted. It is known by the community of the Yasharelites that we have, our ancestors has broken the covenant of Yahuwah. We are living under a curse. That's why these Gentiles have been ruling over us. From that mindset of what was happening in that society, when you hear that no one is justified by the law, but through the faith in HaMashiach Yahusha, then you realize that this is calling a people who have been condemned and cursed to realize that following the law through the flesh has already been proven to be void because we did not do it correctly. However, through HaMashiach, we have another chance, and that is through his death and resurrection. We're going to go through a couple of more scriptures that were written by Paul that people often manipulate. Before we go through that, though, we're going to talk again about the law of the Spirit, and I'm going to lay a foundation, being the foundation of our entire faith. That is the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. If you don't know the Old Covenant, you do not know the New Covenant. Tell that to all of the Christians around the world. If you do not know the Old Covenant, you do not know the New Covenant, period. You might think you know, but based on your Gentile influenced understanding, whether you're Gentile or not, we've all been influenced by Gentile mindsets. Your belief is based on worldly precepts and not on the foundation that Yahuwah has given you. And it's the reason why he says, study to show yourself approved. If you have not studied the Old Testament, do not try to explain the New Testament based on how you interpret a scripture, not based on what the scripture is reflecting. That is back to the original covenant. So we have to understand, as we have said, that the Yasharelites died. We have to understand that spiritually died. Whenever you do not follow the law, you become, the scripture says the wages for sin are death. And we know that not following the law is sin. So whenever Yasharel did not follow the law, they died spiritually, right? They are dead according to the law because the wages for sin is death. Now, we are given a very vivid picture inside of Ezekiel 37 of the nation of Yasharel. It is not a coincidence that it is a valley of dry bones because, again, the wages of sin is death. Yasharel sinned against Yahuwah. They broke the covenant. Therefore, the entire nation was considered dead. They did not follow Yahuwah. Therefore, they have died. Now, Ezekiel 37 literally says in verse 1, the hand of Yahuwah was upon me, and he brought me out by the spirit of Yahuwah and set me down in the middle of the valley, and it was full of bones. He had me pass among them all around, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley, and behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, Yahuwah, Elohim, you know yourself. Again, he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, you dry bones, hear the word of Yahuwah. This is what Yahuwah Elohim says to these bones. Behold, I am going to make breath enter you so that you may come to life. And I will attach my tendons to you, make flesh grow back on you, cover you with skin, put breath in you so that you may come to life and you will know that I am Yahuwah. So I prophesied and I commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a loud noise, and behold, a rattling. The bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked, and behold, the tendons were on them, and flesh grew, and skin covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, Yahuwah, Elohim, says, come from the four winds, breathe and breathe on these slain so that they come to life. So I prophesied and he commanded me, and the breath entered them, and they came to life and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. The very tragedy of the New Testament believers, many New Testament believers, not all, is that they don't relate the baptism where we say we are baptized. You know, when you go underwater, you're considered dead. When you come up from the water, you're considered resurrected. They don't relate that to this exact scripture. We're told, again, the valley of dry bones, we're all dead because of sin. Yet, after dying, Yahusha, he comes back from the dead by the spirit of Yahuwah. It resurrects him. that new creature that we become, that is what the promise is of the new covenant. And we have to emphasize that this is a creature who is dead to themselves. Dead to yourself. I want to be very clear on what that means. That means that my cravings, my desires, my aspirations, all of that is dead. Now I'm a new creature. Literally, I am completely beholden to whatever Yahuwah says. So if I want to be a lawyer, as I am technically and was more so in a previous life, if I want to be a high-class lawyer or something like that, Yahuwah says, no, you're going to do some YouTube ministry. Go ahead, leave it all behind. Guess what? If I'm living by him and not by my flesh, then I am dead to what I want. If I want to be an astronaut and if he says, nope, you can't do it, then that's what I'm doing. If I want to marry this person and he says, nope, you're going to marry this person, then guess what? I'm dead to myself. But I'm trying to give a visual to you all that going against your flesh is something that is completely against the world system. We are told to feed our flesh. We are told to be nurtured by our lusts. We are told to go with whatever we desire. Even if you think about the go do what thou wilt mentality, we are told, even, you know, I was reading a children's book to my son, and I remember it was like, I can be whatever I want to be. And after a while, I'm like, you know what? This book is actually wrong. Like, I don't, sometimes I'll read it, but I'll just change the words. But the idea that I can be what I want to be, no. If I'm a new creature in HaMashiach, I'm a new creature. I can be whatever he calls me to be. I will be what he calls me to be. Forget what I want to be. That whole idea, I can do anything. Oh, I can do whatever Yahuwah allows me to. That's a very different mentality than what we're bred to believe inside of this world system. So again, that's a necessary part of the resurrection. That's the biggest thing that's not taught inside of this grace message that says, grace, we don't worry about the commandments. Well, hold up, grace, the first thing you have to do is die to your lust, die to your flesh, die to yourself, or else you cannot be resurrected. You cannot be resurrected if you are already born, right? Now, I keep going through these scriptures. Some of you might be sick of it, but I need you all to get this drilled into your head if you haven't already, because I'm still getting comments where people are missing the fact that if we are under the new covenant, these Old Testament scriptures are telling us this is what the new covenant is about. So I'm going to read Ezekiel 36:26. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Verse 27, I will put my spirit within you and bring it about that you walk in my statutes and are careful to follow my ordinances. So we are told again that in this new covenant, the purpose is that you walk according to his statutes, that you're careful to do so. Understand the profoundness of this. This is completely against the grace doctrine that says that you don't have to follow the commands. This is saying that if you're in the new covenant, you're careful to follow the commands. You're careful to follow the statutes. So Jeremiah 31:33, again, I've read this before, but I'm going to read it again. For this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Yahshuael after those days, declares Yahuwah. I will put my law within them and write it on their heart, and I will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. Going back to Ezekiel 18:31, hurl away from all your offenses which you have committed and make yourself a new heart and a new spirit. For why should you die, house of Yahshuael? And then Ezekiel 5:7-8. Therefore, this is what Yahuwah Elohim says, because you have more turmoil than the nations that surround you and have not walked in my statutes, nor executed my ordinances, nor act in accordance with the ordinances of the nations around you. Therefore, this is what Yahuwah Elohim says. Behold, I, even I, am against you and will execute judgment among the nations in your sight. Okay, so we've explained that this is all about the picture of the valley of dry bones. Dry bones, they're dead. However, they're going to be resurrected by the Spirit, and we know that Spirit is Yahuwah. Now, relate all of this, all of these Old Testament scriptures talking about the need for a new heart to be able to follow the commandments by your heart and not follow it with a heart of stone. Think about all of these commandments that we've been given. Think about the fact that us breaking the commandments made us a curse, but we have a chance in order to follow the commandments if we can be resurrected by his Spirit. Think about all these things we just talked about as we read through Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is no condemnation at all for those who live in HaMashiach Yahusha. for the law of the Spirit of life in HaMashiach Yahushua has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, Yahuwah did, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh as an offering for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So let me say this again, because this part right here, you're missing, many of you. The requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, I want you to think about this. When it says the requirement of the law, if you are living in your flesh, you're driven by your desires, your lusts, what you want to do in a particular moment. If you're living in the Spirit, all of those things are done away with. So let me give you an example. Let's say that you're watching a movie, and the movie, on a movie, maybe it starts off completely innocent and bland, but eventually there's a lustful scene, like many movies in Hollywood are. Now, if you're living in the Spirit and you see a lustful scene, conviction will tell you, turn this off, shut it down. But if you're living according to your flesh, then you will probably watch it and say, ah, it doesn't matter, you know, it's just a movie. It's not like it's pornography. Like, you'll make excuses, right? So when it tells you that the requirement of the law is fulfilled in us who do not walk in the flesh, but according to the Spirit, what it is literally telling you is that if you're walking in the Spirit, you are walking not by your flesh, meaning you're not sinning. Walking in the Spirit and sin does not work, as I'll show you more explicitly inside of Scripture. But let's go for some more. It says, for those who are in the flesh, set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who are in accord with the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For the mind set on the flesh is death. But the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mind is set on the flesh is hostile toward Yahuwah. Let me say that again. The mindset on the flesh is hostile toward Yahuwah, for it does not subject itself to the law of Yahuwah, for it is not even able to do so. And those who are in the flesh cannot please Yahuwah. So let me just say that again. And this is why I get frustrated when some people try to not understand what Paul is saying. It's literally telling you that you are not, if you're living in the Spirit, you're not living in the flesh, period. There's no in between. I'm half flesh and half spirit. You're in the foot spirit or in the flesh. If you are living in the flesh, then your mind is hostile toward Yahuwah. It also says that you will not subject yourself to the law of Yahuwah. You see how this works. So if you're living according to the flesh, you are not saved, period. And if you have not died to yourself and been resurrected by the Spirit, you are not saved. And you can tell, frankly, if you have not done that, if you are still living in sin. If you're still living in sin, then you have not died to your flesh. You have not been resurrected by the Spirit, because if the Spirit was in you, the Spirit cannot tolerate things that allow sinful behavior and sinful activity. The Spirit would not tolerate that, and the Spirit would leave. Many people have had that happen to where they're following Yah, but nope, unfortunately, I have not done what's necessary to guard Yah's Spirit, and Yah's Spirit is not going to be anywhere where sin abounds. So let's read some more. However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of Yahuwah dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of HaMashiach, he does not belong to him. If HaMashiach is in you through the body, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. What is righteousness? Obviously following the law. But if the Spirit of him who raised Yahushua from the dead dwells in you, he who raised HaMashiach Yahushua from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So then, brothers and sisters, we are under obligation not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you are living in accord with the flesh, you're going to die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are being led by the Spirit of Yahuwah, these are the sons and daughters of Yahuwah. For you have not received the spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons and daughters, by which we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are the children of Elohim. If children, heirs also, heirs of Yahuwah and fellow heirs with HaMashiach, if indeed we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Now, particularly, let's go back to the one scripture where it says, we become sons and daughters. How do you know if you are a son or a daughter of Yahuwah? Well, there's a scripture that tells you very explicitly and very clearly, if you cannot, which I don't understand how, but if you were not able to decipher this through the writings of Paul, there is a scripture that says this very unequivocally, that this is how you know you are born of Yahuwah. 1 John 5, whoever believes that Yahusha is HaMashiach is born of Yahuwah, and whoever loves the Father loves the child born of him. Okay, you might stop right there and say, oh, well, I believe that Yahusha is Elohim, or the son of Elohim. I believe that he is the HaMashiach. I believe that, so I'm good. I don't have to worry about the rest. Well, there's a verse too, and that's why taking verses out of context and not reading the fullness of the verse will really mess some people up with their walk. It says, by this we know that we love the children of Yahuwah, when we love Yahuwah and observe his commandments. For this is the love of Yahuwah, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. Let's read 1 John 3, verses 4 through 10. It says, everyone who practices sin practices lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. Let me say this again. This is scripture. I'm not saying anything from my own mind. This is literally the scripture. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has seen him or knows him. Little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who practices sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. Now listen to this. The Son of Yahuwah appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. No one who is born of Yahuwah practices sin. Now relate this to the verse we just read, that we are now sons of Yahuwah. No one who is born of Yahuwah practices sin, because his seed abides in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of Yahuwah. By this, the children of Yahuwah and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of Yahuwah, nor the one who does not love his brother. So what does this say very explicitly? If you are sinning, you have not been born of Yahuwah. You are not a son of Yahuwah. As Paul said, we become sons and daughters of Yahuwah. Guess what? If you're living in sin, that is a clear evidence, clear as day, that no, you're actually not his child. You're not his son. And listen, there's redemption for all of us. That's what we have to understand, the profoundness of the law of the Spirit. Because it's not like he leaves us hanging. This is supernatural redemption. This is, I will give you a heart of flesh. This is, you can be literally resurrected by the Spirit of Yahuwah, not by your own doing, literally by dying to yourself and going to him, by your new nature as a new creation. Sin will not have residence in you. It's a supernatural occurrence. And when people try to think of it in the flesh, like, oh, how could I not sin? No, that's impossible. When you try to understand it through flesh instead of through spirit, then that's why it doesn't make sense. But when you're looking at it through the spirit, absolutely, you cannot sin. I mean, that goes against a lot of people's thinking, but yes, you can. If you are resurrected by the spirit, you can come out of all sin, not some sin, all sin. Again, with all this in mind, let's go back to those scriptures I wanted to hit. Galatians 3:23 says, but before faith came, we were kept in custody under the law, being confined to the faith that was destined to be revealed. Therefore, the law has become our guardian to lead us to HaMashiach, so that we may be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian, for you are all sons and daughters of Yahuwah through faith in Yahusha HaMashiach. For all of you were baptized in HaMashiach, have clothed yourself with HaMashiach. Therefore, neither Greek, Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for all are one in HaMashiach Yahusha. And if you belong to HaMashiach, you are Abraham's descendant, heirs according to the promise. So what is this literally telling us? If you are born of Yahuwah, if you receive the redemption of Yahusha, then you are no longer being judged by the law. You are no longer being subject to the ramifications of the fact that the covenant was broken. Instead, you get to live a new life of redemption, wherein you, by your new nature, are not sinning. You, by your new nature, are not in rebellion. You, by your new nature, are linked in with the Spirit. Now I want to read one more, Romans 6, 13 through 17. And do not go on presenting the parts of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to Yahuwah as those who are alive from the dead, and your body's parts of as instruments of the righteousness for Yahuwah. For sin shall not master over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. Let that resonate. Being under grace means that from the supernatural power of Yahuwah, sin does not master you. Does not mean that the law is not what you're following. It means that sin does not have the upper hand because of the supernatural redemption of Yahuwah. And it goes on to say, what then? Are we to sin because we're not under the law but under grace? Far from it. Do you not know that the one whom you present yourselves as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of that same one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death or of obedience resulting in righteousness. Thanks be to Yahuwah that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you are entrusted. And notice it says obedient from the heart, because we were told that the new covenant would be one where we have a new heart. So when it says that you are not under the law, why are you not under the law? Again, you have to remember the context of the place where Paul is coming from. He's coming from a nation that was cursed by the law, but they're no longer under that curse because they're under grace. As we said, the grace that Yahuwah gave to Yasharel was a second chance, despite the fact they definitely did not deserve it. He gave them a second chance. So that, my brothers and sisters, is the law of the Spirit. It is not what we have been told by mainstream Christianity, this idea that you are saved and the law is done away with. You literally will not find one scripture that says the law is done away with inside of the New Testament. People have taken scriptures that say things like, you're not under the law, and they've twisted it to say, this means that the law is done away with. Instead of thinking, well, the law became a curse to Yasharel, and they're no longer under the curse. Therefore, they're under God's grace for him giving them a second chance. That is the law of the Spirit that we live by. It's a Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, that inhabits us. And once you die to yourself and give yourself over to him, he will make you a new creature. That is where faith will save you. Because lawlessness, you have to understand, Yah in his perfection would never tolerate lawlessness. Yah in his goodness and his holiness would never tolerate lawlessness. What he does offer you, if you're willing to again forsake yourself, is he offers you a chance to take on a new identity in him. Receive the Spirit, and from that Spirit, change your ways. Let him direct your ways, direct your thoughts. Let him be the one who is steering you at every step. Instead of serving your own lusts like the world around us, you get to serve him. That is what is offered to you. Now, whether or not you will receive it, that is obviously up to each and every one of you. I hope that was clear. That was the teaching on the law of the Spirit. We will continue on with this law series next time, but Yah willing, I will see you in the next video.
We believe in the resurrection of the dead. We believe that the 20 million black people in America in the last day will be taught the truth. The trumpet of truth will sound in your ear. That is being sounded today, the trumpet of truth. And this truth strikes your ear, strikes your heart. It'll open your eyes. It'll open your ears. It'll make you stand up. It'll do the same thing for you that truth did for the dry bones in the valley. Because the picture of dry bones in the valley is talking about you. The picture of Lazarus laying dead 4 days is talking about you. You are Lazarus. You are the dry bones. You are the prodigal son. You are the lost sheep. You are the people about whom the Bible is speaking who will stand up in the last day when the trumpet is sounded. Black people are waking up. Black people are standing up. Black people are rising up and they're going back. We believe we are the people of God's choice. That's what we believe. We believe we're the chosen people. We don't believe Jews are the chosen people. We don't believe Jews are the ones going to the promised land. We don't think Jews are part of God. No. Nothing but another part of that same race of devils that come out of Europe. They didn't even come out of the Holy Land. They come out of the caves of Europe. We furthermore, we believe we are the people of God's choice. As it is written, that God would choose the rejected and despised. And we can find no other person fitting this description in these last days more than the so-called Negroes in America. We believe in the resurrection of the righteous. We believe in the judgment. We believe this first judgment will take place as God reveals right here in America. Right. The judgment will take place in America. The resurrection will take place in America. The judgment will take place in America. The separation will take place in America. And the destruction will take place in America. Doom will take place in America. Doomsday will take place right here. This is the place the Bible is talking about. When the and Babylon it means America. When the Bible mentions Sodom and Gomorrah, that's America. When the Bible mentions Egypt, that's America. This is Rome. This is Babylon. This is that wicked kingdom that God is going to come and set fire to.
The Valley of Dry Bones, as recounted in Ezekiel 37, the prophet Ezekiel finds himself in a desolate landscape filled with lifeless bones. Symbolizing the exiled Israelite's spiritual state and hopelessness, God poses a question: can these bones live? In response, Ezekiel acknowledges only God's knowledge. God commands Ezekiel to prophesy over the bones, and as he does, a rattling occurs. The bones come together, sinews attach, flesh forms, and skin covers them, but they remain lifeless. God instructs Ezekiel to prophesy breath into the bones, and a mighty wind breathes life into them. This vision portrays God's promise to restore the people of Israel, breathing new life into their spiritual and national revival.